Thanks. Okay, so I'm going to introduce away. I'm so happy to be here. What a happy occasion, a new translation of Pushkin. To situate Pushkin's prose a little bit. So Pushkin isn't the best known of Russian writers here, but in Russia, he's like above and beyond. Like, it's hard to overstate the love and delight that Pushkin generates in people. Analog for English-speaking audiences, he's often compared to Shakespeare, which is a good comparison because he also invented the modern language to an extent. But there's another comparison that I like even better. Well, I mean, not that it's a contest, which is which is Mozart, who died in 1791, and Pushkin was born in 1799. And but there's just a kind of effervescence and playfulness and virtuosity and a total respect of these kind of classical, courtly, elegant forms, which could be very constricting, but somehow Pushkin, I think like Mozart, turns them into a way to always find freedom and to somehow, he somehow seems like the most free and constraint escaping of poets, even though he observes form and rhyme so rigorously. And in life, as well as in writing, he had an ambivalent attitude toward boundaries and confines. He was he had liberal, radical sympathies from an early age. He was sympathetic to the Decembrist uprising, which was when Russian officers in 1825 led 3,000 soldiers to protest Nikolai I's assumption of the throne. And those people were probably feeling things similar to how some of us feel now. And Pushkin got in a lot of trouble for sympathizing with them. And we may think that our lives are difficult now, and our lives indeed are difficult now, but Pushkin's was worse. He was always being exiled, which was actually good because otherwise he might not have written anything. It was always when he would get sent somewhere very boring, that would be when he would write these just amazing things. He always wanted to leave the country. It was his dream to go to Paris, and he never got to go, even though he knew all of French literature. French was his first language. So that's sad, although he did get to go to Turkey, which he kind of, not really the cool part of Turkey, like they're all cool, but the eastern part, so, and he wrote this travelogue, Journey to Arzurum, which used to be very hard to find in English, but it's now in a beautiful new translation, and it's available in this wonderful book that we're celebrating today. So it's an extra happy occasion because of that. Pushkin switched, so he's famous as a poet, and then he made this kind of drastic switch to prose. He talked all kinds of smack about prose and when he was younger in the 1820s, and he talked about descending to prose as Richard Pevear has written in the very nice introduction to this volume. And then he just sort of switched in this sort of weird, characteristic, very elegant move, like everything else that he did, and just started writing all of this very odd prose, odd but perfect and beautiful. And every prose writer that you love from the Russian 19th century loved the prose of Pushkin. It's hard to overstate his influence. Everyone from, I don't know, this has been a happy occasion for me to reread the prose and a happy occasion for people to read and reread. And just noticing echoes. The ones that particularly struck me were both Gogol and Tolstoy this time. And they're such different writers, and they're both so formed by these little enigmatic fragments that are just so beautiful to have in a book. So I just want to tell you one story, which is also mentioned in the introduction to this book. My favorite Pushkin prose influence story, which is about Tolstoy when he was writing Anna Karenina. He had a lot of trouble writing Anna Karenina, and the formalist critic Boris Eichenbaum wrote this wonderful book, Tolstoy in the 70s, where he writes about the different drafts and the struggles and what Tolstoy was reading. And there's this wonderful story about how his wife one day took down this volume of Pushkin's prose from the shelf to read to the kids, who I think if I remember right, they didn't like, they were too young, they didn't understand it. But anyway, so Tolstoy picked it up and started looking. He was like, oh, this is really good. And the particular, he mentions a few of the different pieces, but one of them is the fragment, "The Guests Were Arriving at the Dacha." And it's this beautiful fragment that just starts, "The guests were arriving at the dacha." And just when you, just even when you read that fragment, you can feel all the momentum and the, and he said there's, he wrote in a letter to some guy that he then did not send. Now that's how to write. Pushkin goes straight to the point. Another writer would have described the guests and the rooms, but he goes straight to the action. And he says after he read that, he just sat down and immediately started writing, which is clearly a stylized description of how a novel gets written. But you can feel the energy and the inspiration there. And when you look at the beginning of Anna Karenina, it, I mean, I think it has this operatic Mozart-like kind of feeling, which I think, oh, that was the other thing that I was going to say. Sorry, the comparison of Pushkin to Mozart. Pushkin was conscious of that, I think, that comparison himself, and the movie Amadeus that people may know was based loosely on a play that was based on one of Pushkin's little tragedies. And there's this theme of virtuosity that keeps coming again and again. Particularly, I think, in Pushkin's prose, and it's not always a good thing. Like, this curse of virtuosity is something that you live with, is something that is always with him. Anyway, back to Tolstoy. Yes. So then he started writing Anna Karenina after this passage of the guests were arriving at the dacha, and then Eichenbaum says that if you look at that little fragment, you could imagine it being just a perfect little epigraph to Anna Karenina. Particularly, there's a line later where he talks about this countess, and he says, you know, there's more good in her than is known, and less bad, but passion will be the ruin of her. And it's true, that could be a perfect little epigraph to Anna Karenina. And Eichenbaum has written a lot about the relationship between Pushkin and Tolstoy, and that Anna Karenina is the continuation of Yevgeny Onegin. But almost the way it seems to me is if you read this perfect little fragment from Pushkin, and then you might fall asleep and have some huge, crazy, complicated dream, and that dream might be Anna Karenina. And in a way, you can look at all the prose works of the 19th century, I mean, maybe not all of them, but a lot of them, as if, you know, everyone read one of these little fragments and then fell asleep, and their whole big dream that they had is Russian literature. And it's so fitting that after all of the novels that Richard Pevear and Larissa Volokhonsky have translated, they've now turned to the prose of Pushkin. They've been great heroes of mine since 2004, when they made Anna Karenina an Oprah pick. It's such a delight and a wonder that every few years a new Russian classic is translated, and everyone, and they come out in these beautiful editions, and everyone reads them, and everyone talks about them, and everyone argues about them, and they're alive again, and that's such a wonderful gift. Thank you. Now they're going to read from Pushkin.
You'll have to change your talk a little bit, yes. Since she did it.
Elif has robbed me of the beginning of my introduction, but it's just as well. I was going to give this same reference to Tolstoy, but anyway, thank you for your introduction. Thank you, Bernard, for inviting us, and we're very happy to be back at the Y again.
Thank you all for coming here.
Yes. The title, the subtitle of our collection, the complete prose of Alexander Pushkin, is not quite accurate. There are no letters, no diaries, no. He also kept a wonderful little notebook of thoughts. None of that is included, but we include almost all the fiction that Pushkin wrote, fragments or completed works, and also this long nonfiction piece, The Journey to Our's Room. Pushkin deliberately, he was a sort of instinctive poet, if that's possible. I guess that is what poets are. But he deliberately worked on prose, and he stated that prose should be the opposite of poetry. And his prose is the opposite of his verse. It's extremely precise, extremely brief. He condenses everything. Although he was living in the Romantic era, his poetics, or prosaics, I guess you'd call them, are very classical. I always liked the phrase that the Russian writer, dissident writer, Andrei Sinyavsky, he wrote a book about Pushkin while he was in prison called Walks with Pushkin. And in one place in it, he says, Pushkin is the golden section of Russian literature. Having thrust it forcefully into the future, he himself fell back and now plays in it the role of an eternally flowering past to which it returns to be rejuvenated. This anecdote about Tolstoy is a very good example of that. Tolstoy read this book of prose for the seventh time, he said, and just couldn't stop. He picked it up and couldn't stop reading it. He even said that, never have I admired Pushkin so much, nor anyone else for that matter. And he described how he started writing this novel, which after 6 years became Anna Karenina. Well, so I'll read from, since Pushkin was both a poet and a prose writer, and sometimes he put the two together. So I'll start with reading a part of a fragment called Egyptian Nights. It describes a Russian dandy and well-off Petersburg gentleman, very much image of Pushkin himself, who was a social bon vivant, but in private, a poet. One day a stranger comes to him, an Italian from Naples, who says that he is an improvisator, and which means that he would appear in public and the public would give him a subject and he would immediately recite perfectly rhythmic, rhymed verse on that subject.
It's a rare gift. It's the example of this virtuosity that Elif was talking about.
And actually, Pushkin himself ran into this phenomenon in Petersburg with the poet, the greatest Polish poet, Adam Mickiewicz, who was at that time living in Petersburg and could also improvise poetry. And Pushkin said, how the hell does he do that? Because Pushkin had to work at his work. So this is a story very much based on his own experience. But anyway, he meets this one day, this Neapolitan improvisator comes to Charsky and says, look, you've got to set me up some kind of an event so I can make some money. And Charsky gets interested, and since he knows all of Petersburg society, he gathers a group of people, and they all agree to come and to hear the improvisator. And so he arranges the whole evening, and now he comes to looking for the Neapolitan, who remains nameless, in order to tell him that the evening will take place. And this is the part I'll read. The next day, Charsky was searching for room number 35 in the dark and dirty corridor of an inn. He stopped at a door and knocked. Yesterday's Italian opened it. Victory, Charsky said to him. Your affair is in the hat. Princess offers you her reception room. At a rout yesterday, I managed to recruit half of Petersburg. Print the tickets and announcements. I guarantee you, if not a triumph, at least gain. And that's the main thing, cried the Italian, expressing his joy with the lively gestures peculiar to his southern race. I knew you would help me. Corpo di Bacco, you're a poet the same as I am, and whatever you say, poets are fine lads. How can I show you my gratitude? Wait, Would you like to hear an improvisation? An improvisation? You mean you can do without the public, without music, without the thunder of applause? Trifles, trifles. Where could I find myself a better public? You're a poet, you'll understand me better than they will, and your quiet approval is dearer to me than a whole storm of applause. Sit down somewhere and give me a theme. Tcharsky sat down on a suitcase. Of the two chairs in the cramped little hovel, one was broken and the other heaped with papers and underwear. The improvisator took a guitar from the table and stood before Tcharsky, strumming it with his bony fingers and awaiting his order. "Here's a theme for you," Tcharsky said to him. Quote, "The poet himself chooses the subjects of his songs. The mob has no right to control his inspiration." The Italian's eyes flashed. He played several chords, proudly raised his head, and passionate stanzas expressive of instantaneous emotion flew harmoniously from his lips. Here they are, freely passed on by one of our friends from words preserved in Tcharsky's memory. "The poet goes, eyes open wide, and yet he sees no one at all. Meanwhile, drawing him aside, a passing stranger asks, appalled, 'Tell me, why this aimless wandering? No sooner have you scaled the heights than you are bent upon descending into the vale as dark as night. The well-formed world you see but vaguely, a fruitless ardor wears you out. Some paltry matter constantly lures you and beckons you about. A genius should strive toward the heavens. The true poet, to the true poet it belongs to choose himself the purest leaven as matter for inspired songs.
Зачем крутится ветер во враге, подъемлет лист и пыль несет, когда корабль в недвижной влаге, его дыхание жадно ждет? Зачем от гор и мимо башен летит орел тяжел и страшен на чахлый пень? Спроси его. Зачем арапа своего младая любит Дездемона, как месяц любит ночи мглу? Затем, что ветру и орлу, и сердцу девы нет закона. Гордись, таков и ты поэт, и для тебя закона нет.
Which is the original of what I'll now read. Why is it that wind whirls and scatters leaves and dust across the heath, while a ship on unmoving waters languishes, longing for its breath? Why from the peaks past lofty towers does the great eagle for all his powers fly down to a withered stump? Ask him. Why does young Desdemona trim her love for a blackamoor's delight as the moon loves the dark of night? Because law has no hold upon eagle or wind or a maiden's heart. Such is the poet, like Aquilon, he takes what he fancies for his part, then eagle-like he flies away. And asking no one, he aspires like Desdemona in her day to the idol of his heart's desires. The Italian fell silent. Tcharsky said nothing, amazed and moved. Well, so? Asked the improvisator. Tcharsky seized his hand and pressed it hard. So? Asked the improvisator. How was it? Astonishing, the poet replied. How can it be? Another man's thought barely grazed your hearing, and it's already your own, as if you nurtured it, cherished it, developed it all the while. So neither toil nor coldness nor that restlessness that precedes inspiration exists for you? Astonishing, astonishing. The improvisator replied, every talent is inexplicable. How is it that a sculptor sees the hidden Jupiter in a block of Carrara marble and brings him to light by smashing his casing with a chisel and hammer? Why does a thought emerge from a poet's head already armed with four rhymes, measured out in regular harmonious feet? So no one except the improvisator himself can understand the quickness of impressions, this close connection between his own inspiration and another's external will. It would be futile for me to try to explain it myself. However, we must think about my first night. What do you say? What price should we put on a ticket so that it's not too hard for the public and I still don't come out the loser? They say Signora Catalani took 25 rubles. A decent price. It was unpleasant for Tcharsky to fall suddenly from the heights of poetry under a clerk's counter. But he understood worldly necessity very well and entered into the Italian's mercantile calculations. The Italian on this occasion displayed such savage greed, such simple-hearted love of gain, that Charsky found him repulsive and hastened to leave so as not to lose all the feeling of admiration that the brilliant improvisator had aroused in him. The preoccupied Italian did not notice this change and accompanied him through the corridor and down the stairs with deep bows and assurances of eternal gratitude.
I'll read an excerpt from the novel Dubrovsky. It is a novel with a gentleman robber as a hero. At the turn of the 19th century, there was a lot of works of romantic literature and, about gentlemen robbers. They were all the fashion. Schiller, Walter Scott, Anne Radcliffe were all translated into Russian and were immensely popular. So the topic was not new, but Pushkin, as usual, plays with the genre and introduces his own vision, his own style, clear, terse, totally unromantic, and with underlying strain of irony. This is from the middle of the novel. The reader has probably guessed that Kirilla Petrovich's daughter, of whom we have as yet said only a few words, is the heroine of our story. In the period we're describing, she was 17 years old, and her beauty was in full bloom. Her father loved her to distraction, but treated her with his own special willfulness, now trying to cater to her slightest whims, then frightening her with severe and sometimes cruel treatment. Assured of her affection, he could never gain her confidence. She was used to concealing her feelings, and thoughts from him, because she could never know for certain how they would be received. She had no friends and grew up in solitude. The neighbors' wives and daughters rarely visited Kirilla Petrovich, whose habitual conversation and amusements called for the camaraderie of men and not the presence of ladies. Rarely did our beauty appear among the guests feasting at Kirilla Petrovich's, an enormous library consisting for the most part of works by 18th century French writers was put at her disposal. Her father, who never read anything except The Perfect Cook, could not guide her in the choice of books, and Masha, having lived through works of various sorts, quite naturally settled on novels. It was thus that she completed her education, begun previously under the guidance of Mademoiselle Mimi, her governess, to whom Kirilla Petrovich had shown great confidence and benevolence, and whom he had finally been forced to send quietly to another estate once the consequences of his friendship became too obvious. Mademoiselle Mimi left quite a pleasant memory behind her. She was a good girl and never misused the influence she obviously had over Kirilla Petrovich, differing in this from other confidants who were replaced every minute. Kirilla Petrovich himself seemed to have liked her more than the others, and the dark-eyed boy, a scamp of about 9, recalling Mademoiselle Mimi's southern features, was brought up in the house and recognized as his son, though many barefoot children, as like him as 2 drops of water, ran around outside his windows and were considered serfs. For his little Sasha, Kirilla Petrovich invited a French tutor from Moscow who arrived in Pokrovskoye during the events we're now describing. Kirilla Petrovich liked this tutor for his pleasant appearance and simple manners. He presented Kirilla Petrovich with his references and a letter from one of Troikurov's relations with whom he had lived for 4 years as a tutor. Kirilla Petrovich looked through it all and was displeased only by his Frenchman's youth, not that he considered this agreeable drawback and compatible with the patience and experience so necessary to the unfortunate position of tutor, but he had doubts of his own, which he decided at once to explain to him. For that, he ordered Masha to be sent to him. Kirilla Petrovich did not speak French, and she served as his interpreter. "Come here, Masha, tell this monsieur that so be it, I'll take him, only provided that he not dare to go chasing after my girls, otherwise I'll show this son of a dog." Translate that for him, Masha. Masha blushed and, turning to the tutor, told him in French that her father hoped for his modesty and proper behavior. The Frenchman bowed and replied that he hoped to earn respect even if favor were denied him. Masha translated his reply word for word. All right," said Kirill Petrovich. "He has no need of favor or respect. His business is to look after Sasha and teach him grammar and geography. Translate that for him." Marya Kirillovna softened her father's crude expressions in her translation, and Kirill Petrovich sent his Frenchman off to the wing where a room had been assigned to him. Masha, having been brought up with aristocratic prejudices, paid no attention to the young Frenchman. For her, a tutor was a sort of servant or artisan, and servants or artisans did not seem like men to her. Nor did she notice the impression she had made on Monsieur Deforge, his confusion, his trembling, his altered voice. After that, for several days in a row, she met him rather often without paying any great attention to him. In an unexpected way, she acquired a completely new idea of him. Several bear cubs were usually reared in Kirill Petrovich's yard and constituted one of the Pokrovskaya landowner's chief amusements. While still young, the cubs would be brought each day to the drawing room, where Kirill Petrovich would spend hours at a time playing with them, setting them at cats and puppies. Grown up, they would be put on chains in anticipation of real baiting. Kirill Petrovich used them to play cruel jokes on his guests. To his mind, the best joke was the following. A hungry bear would be locked in an empty room, tied with a rope to a ring screwed into the wall. The rope was almost the length of the whole room, so that only the opposite corner would be safe from the fearsome beast's attack. They would bring someone, usually a novice, to the door of this room, as if inadvertently shove him in with the bear, lock the door, and the unfortunate victim would be left alone with the shaggy hermit. The poor guest, his coattails shredded and himself scratched and bleeding, would soon find the safe corner, but would sometimes be forced to stand for whole 3 hours, pressed to the wall and watch as the infuriated beast, 2 steps away, roared, jumped, reared, and strained, trying to reach him. Such were the noble amusements of the Russian squire. A few days after the tutor's arrival, Troyekurov remembered about him and conceived the idea of treating him to the bear room. To that end, summoning him one morning, he led him along the dark corridors. Suddenly a side door opened, 2 servants shoved the Frenchman in and locked the door with a key. Coming to his senses, the tutor saw the tied up bear. The beast began to snort, sniffing at his guest from a distance, and suddenly rising on his hind legs, came towards him. The Frenchman did not panic, did not run, but waited for the attack. The bear came close. Deforge drew a small pistol from his pocket, put it into the hungry beast's ear, and fired. The bear collapsed. Everyone came running, the door opened, Kirill Petrovich came in, amazed at the outcome of his joke. Kirill Petrovich wanted the whole matter explained at once. Who had warned Deforge of the joke prepared for him, or why was there a loaded pistol in his pocket? He sent for Masha. Masha came running and translated her father's question for the Frenchman. "I had not heard about the bear," Deforge replied, "but I always carry pistols on me because I do not intend to put up with offenses for which, owing to my position, I cannot demand satisfaction." Masha looked at him in amazement and translated his words for Kirill Petrovich. Kirill Petrovich made no reply, ordered the bear taken away and skinned, then turning to his servants, he said, "There's a fine fellow. He wasn't scared. By God, he wasn't scared." From that moment on, he came to like Deforge and no longer thought of testing him. But this incident made a still greater impression on Marya Kirillovna. Her imagination was struck. She saw the dead bear and Deforge calmly standing over him and calmly conversing with her. She saw the courage and proud self-esteem did not belong exclusively to one estate, and from then on she began to show the young tutor a respect which grew more attentive by the hour. Certain relations were established between them. Masha had a beautiful voice and great musical ability. Deforge volunteered to give her lessons. After that, it would not be hard for the reader to guess that Masha fell in love with him, though she did not yet admit it to herself.
Among the works in our collection, there are also a few completed works that Pushkin wrote during his lifetime. The two greatest of them are the Queen of Spades, which I suppose everyone knows. There's been opera, ballet, films, and so on. The other is the novel, The Captain's Daughter. The Queen of Spades is a very complex story with a very simple appearance. It's very intensely written. It's very, very, concentrated. It's satirical, it's mystical, but essentially it's about the passion for gambling, for card playing, which Pushkin himself felt very well. The hero is a man named Hermann. He is an officer in the Engineers Corps in Petersburg, but obviously a foreigner by his name. And he has no personal fortune. He lives on his military pay. But he's obsessed with card playing. He goes to the card playing at different noblemen's houses all the time and watches. He can't afford to gamble, but he watches. And during the talk that goes on during the gambling games, he hears about an old woman, a countess, who knows three certain winning cards. And he, of course, immediately wants to know what they are. The old countess, who's still alive, lives in Petersburg, has a young ward, a young girl, poor girl, who lives with her, named Lisa.
Pretty young girl.
In order to get to the countess, Hermann starts paying court to Lisa. Lisa first holds him off, but then begins to fall for him and eventually makes an arrangement to meet him in the house. She lives in the attic above the countess's rooms. And she makes this date and tells him where to go and how to get to her. And Hermann is delighted, but he's delighted because he wants not the ward, but the countess. And so he comes to the house, and this is the section that I'll read. Hermann trembled like a tiger, waiting for the appointed time. By 10 o'clock, he was already standing in front of the countess's house. The weather was awful. Wind howled, wet snow fell in big flakes. The street lamps shone dimly, the streets were deserted. Now and then a cabbie dragged by with his scrawny nag looking for a late customer. Hermann stood in nothing but his frock coat, feeling neither wind nor snow. At last the countess's carriage was brought. Hermann saw how the lackeys carried the bent old woman out under the arms, wrapped in a sable fur coat, and how after her, her ward flashed by in a light cloak, her head adorned with fresh flowers. The doors slammed, the carriage rolled off heavily over the loose snow. The doorman shut the front door, the windows went dark. Hermann started pacing around by the now deserted house. He went up to a street lamp, looked at his watch. It was 11:20. He stayed under the street lamp, his eyes on the hands of the watch, counting the remaining minutes. At exactly 11:30, Hermann stepped onto the countess's porch and went into the brightly lit entryway. The doorman was not there. Hermann ran up the stairs, opened the door to the front hall, and saw a servant sleeping under a lamp in an old soiled armchair. Hermann walked past him with a light and firm step. The reception room and drawing room were dark. The lamp in the front hall shone faintly on them. Hermann went into the bedroom. Before a stand filled with old icons flickered a golden lamp, faded damask armchairs and sofas with down cushions and worn-off gilding stood in mournful symmetry against the walls covered with Chinese silk. On the walls hung two portraits painted in Paris by Madame Lebrun. One of them portrayed a man of about 40, red-cheeked and portly in a light green uniform and with a decoration. The other a young beauty with an aquiline nose, her hair brushed back at the temples, powdered and adorned with a rose. Every corner was jammed with porcelain shepherdesses, table clocks made by the famous Le Roi, little boxes, bandoliers, fans, and various ladies' knickknacks invented at the end of the last century, along with Montgolfier's balloon and Mesmer's magnetism. Hermann went behind the screen. There stood a small iron bed. To the right was the door leading to the study, to the left, the other, to the corridor. Hermann opened it, saw the narrow winding stairway leading to the poor ward's room, but he came back and went into the dark study. Time passed slowly, all was quiet. In the drawing room it struck 12. In all the rooms, one after another, the clocks rang 12, and all fell silent again. Hermann stood leaning against the cold stove. He was calm, his heart beat regularly, as in a man who has ventured upon something dangerous but necessary. The clock struck 1, and then 2 in the morning, and he heard the distant clatter of a carriage. An involuntary agitation overcame him. The carriage drove up and stopped. He heard the clatter of the flipped down steps. There was bustling in the house. Servants ran, voices rang out, and the house lit up. 3 elderly maids rushed into the bedroom, and the countess, barely alive, came in and sank into the Voltaire armchair. Hermann watched through a chink. Lizaveta Ivanovna, that's the ward, walked past him. Hermann heard her hurrying footsteps on the stairs. Something like remorse of conscience stirred in his heart and died down again. He turned to stone. The countess started to undress before the mirror. They unpinned her bonnet, decorated with roses, took the powdered wig from her gray and close-cropped head. Pins poured down like rain around her. The yellow gown embroidered with silver fell at her swollen feet. Hermann witnessed the repulsive mysteries of her toilette. Finally, the countess was left in a bed jacket and nightcap. In this attire, more suitable to her old age, she seemed less horrible and ugly. Like all old people generally, the countess suffered from insomnia. Having undressed, she sat down by the window in the Voltaire armchair and dismissed her maids. The candles were taken away. The room was again lit only by the icon lamp. The countess sat all yellow, moving her pendulous lips, swaying from side to side. Her dull eyes showed a complete absence of thought. Looking at her, one might have thought that the frightful old woman's swaying came not from her will, but from the action of some hidden galvanism. Suddenly, that dead face changed inexplicably. Her lips stopped moving. Her eyes came to life. Before the countess stood an unknown man. "Don't be afraid, for God's sake, don't be afraid," he said in a clear and low voice. "I have no intention of harming you. I've come to beg you for a favor." The old woman silently looked at him and seemed not to hear him. Hermann thought she might be deaf, and bending close to her ear, repeated the same words. The old woman was silent as before. "You can make for the happiness of my life," Hermann continued, "and it won't cost you anything. I know that you can guess 3 cards in a row." Hermann stopped. The countess seemed to have understood and what was asked of her. It seemed she was seeking words for her reply. "That was a joke," she said at last. "I swear to you, it was a joke." "It was no joke," Hermann retorted angrily. "Remember Chaplitsky, whom you helped to win back his losses." The countess was visibly disconcerted. Her features showed strong emotion, but she soon lapsed into her former insensibility. "Can you name those 3 sure cards for me?" Hermann continued. The countess said nothing. Hermann went on. whom are you keeping your secret for? Your grandchildren? They're rich without that. And besides, they don't know the value of money. Your three cards won't help a squanderer. A man who can't hold on to his paternal inheritance will die a pauper anyway for all the devil's efforts. I'm not a squanderer. I know the value of money. Your three cards won't be wasted on me. Well, he stopped and waited in trembling for her reply. The Countess said nothing. Hermann went on his knees. If your heart has ever known the feeling of love, he said, if you remember its raptures, if you smiled even once at the cry of your newborn son, if anything human has ever beaten in your breast, I entreat you, by the feelings of a wife, a mistress, a mother, by all that is sacred in life, do not refuse my request. Reveal your secret to me. What good is it to you? Perhaps it's connected with a terrible sin, with the forfeit of eternal bliss, a pact with the devil. Think, you're old, you don't have long to live. I'm ready to take your sin upon my soul. Only reveal your secret to me. Think, a man's happiness is in your hands, not only I, but my children, my grandchildren, great-grandchildren will bless your memory and revere it as sacred. The old woman did not say a word. Hermann stood up. Old witch, he said, clenching his teeth, then I'll make you answer. With these words, he took a pistol from his pocket. At the sight of the pistol, the Countess showed strong emotion for the second time. She shook her head and raised her hand as if to shield herself from the shot. Then she fell backwards and remained motionless. Stop being childish, said Hermann, taking her hand. I ask you for the last time, will you name your three cards for me, yes or no? The Countess did not reply. Hermann saw that she had died.
I will read from The Captain's Daughter. It's a short novel. It has been called by some one of the best novels ever written. I won't sing praises to it. I love it. I will only say that it is an extraordinary novel about the most ordinary things and the most ordinary people. It combines, as Walter Scott's novels, it combines the events of history, of Russian history, with the personal destiny of a young officer. In the beginning of the novel, a very young officer, he's 16. And a young girl, the captain's daughter of the title, the great role in the workings of this destiny belongs to three qualities. Honor, gratitude, and mercy. And they are shown by almost all the characters of the story, except one. And across all social divisions, from a cruel robber and rebel to the Russian Empress herself. It's a very extraordinary book. In the second chapter of this book, the hero, who is, as I said, 16 years old, travels to a remote place in the provinces where he's assigned to serve in the army. He is accompanied by his old servant, Savelich. I was drawing near to my destination. Around me stretched a dismal wasteland crosscut by hills and ravines. Everything was covered with snow. The sun was setting. Our kibitka drove along the narrow road, or rather track, left by peasant sledges. Suddenly the driver started looking to one side and finally taking off his cap, turned around to me and said, sir, won't you order me to turn back? Why? The weather's uncertain, the wind's picking up a little. See how it's sweeping off the fresh snow. What's the harm in that? And do you see that there? The driver pointed to the east with his whip. I see nothing but the white steppe and the clear sky. No, there, over there, that little cloud. I did, in fact, see a white cloud on the edge of the horizon, which I took at first for a distant hill. The driver explained to me that the little cloud heralded a storm. I had heard about the blizzard in those parts and knew that they could bury the whole trains of sledges. Savelich, it is the servant, Savelich, agreeing with the driver, advised me to turn back. But the wind did not seem strong to me. I hoped to reach the next posting station in good time and told them to speed it up. The driver went into a gallop, but he kept glancing to the east. The horses raced swiftly. The wind, meanwhile, was growing stronger by the minute. The little cloud turned into a white storm cloud, which rose heavily, grew, and gradually covered the sky. Fine snow began to fall, and suddenly thick flakes came pouring down. The wind howled. A blizzard set in. In one moment, the dark sky blended with the sea of snow. Everything vanished. "Well, sir," shouted the driver, "bad luck. It's a snowstorm." I peeked out of the kibitka. Everything was dark and whirling. The wind howled with such fierce expressiveness that it seemed animate. Savelich and I were covered with snow. The horses slowed to a walk and soon stopped. "Why don't you go on?" I asked the driver impatiently. "Why go on?" he replied, climbing down from the box. "We don't know where we've got to as it is. There's no road and darkness all around." I started to scold him. Savelich interceded for him. "Why on earth didn't you listen to him?" he said angrily. "You should have gone back to the inn, drunk your tea, slept till morning. The storm would have died down. We would have gone on. What's the hurry? It's not as if there is a wedding." Savelich was right. There was nothing to be done. The snow just poured down. A drift was piling up around the kibitka. The horses stood hanging their heads and shuddering occasionally. The driver walked around and, having nothing to do, kept adjusting the harness. Savelich grumbled. I looked in all directions, hoping to see at least some sign of a dwelling or a road, but could make out nothing except the hazy whirl of the blizzard. Suddenly, I saw something black. "Hey, driver," I shouted. "Look, what's that black shape over there?" The driver strained his eyes. "God knows, master," he said, climbing back into his seat. "Could be a wagon, could be a tree, but it seems like it's moving. Must be either a wolf or a man." I ordered him to drive towards the unknown object, which at once started to move towards us. 2 minutes later, we came up to a man. "Hey, my good man," the driver called to him. "Tell us, do you know where the road is?" "The road is right here. I'm standing on a firm strip of it," the wayfarer said. "But what use is that?" "Listen, friend," I said to him. "Are you familiar with these parts? Can you lead me to a night's lodgings?" "I am familiar with these parts," the wayfarer replied. "By God, I've roamed and ridden all over them. But you see what the weather is like. You are sure to lose your way. Better stay here and wait it out. Maybe the storm will die down and the sky will clear. Then we'll find our way by the stars." His cool-headedness encouraged me. I had already resolved to entrust myself to God's will and spend the night in the middle of the steppe, when the wayfarer suddenly climbed nimbly up the box and said to the driver, "Well, by God, there is a house nearby. Turn right and drive on." "Why should I go to the right?" the driver asked with displeasure. "Where do you see a road?" "Oh, yes, yes, of course. Why spare another man's horse?" The driver seemed right to me. In fact, I said, "What makes you think there is a house nearby?" "Because the wind blew from there, said the wayfarer, "and I smelled smoke. We must be close to a village." His shrewdness and keen sense of smell amazed me. I told the driver to go there. The horses stepped heavily through the deep snow. The kibitka moved slowly, now driving up a drift, now sinking into a gully, and tilting now to one side, now to the other. It was like a ship sailing on a stormy sea. Savelich groaned and kept lurching into me. I lowered the matting, wrapped myself in my fur coat, and dozed off, lulled by the singing of the storm and the rocking of the slowly moving kibitka. What follows is a very interesting dream, but I can't read it now because we have to have no time. But there is this dream,
you'll have
which
to
in
buy
a sense
the book,
a prophetic, prophetic, in a sense a prophetic, a very symbolic dream. And then the young man wakes up. They spend the night in this inn that they found. And in the morning, they are preparing to go on, to proceed on their way. Waking up rather late the next morning, I saw that the storm had abated. The sun was shining. Snow lay in a dazzling mantle over the boundless steppe. The horses were harnessed. I paid the innkeeper, who took such a moderate payment that even Savelich did not argue with him and start bargaining, as he usually did. And the previous day's suspicions were completely erased from his mind. I summoned our guide, thanked him for his help, and told Savelich to tip him half a ruble. Savelich frowned. "Tip him half a ruble," he said. "What for? Because you were so good as to bring him to the inn? Say what you like, sir. We have no extra half rubles. If we tip, everybody will go hungry ourselves soon enough." I could not argue with Savelich. The money, by my promise, was entirely at his disposal. I was annoyed, however, that I could not thank a man who had saved me, if not from disaster, at least from a very unpleasant situation. "Very well," I said coolly. "If you don't want to give him half a ruble, find him something from my clothes. He's dressed too lightly. Give him my hareskin coat." "Mercy me, dear Peter Andreich," said Savelich. "Why give him your hareskin coat? The dog will drink it up at the first pothouse." "You needn't fret, old fellow," said my vagabond, "whether I drink it up or not. His honor is granting me a coat off his back. That's your master's will, and your serf business is to obey, not to argue." "You've got no fear of God, you robber," Savelich replied in an angry voice. "You see, the little one still can't reason. You're glad to fleece him on account of his simplicity. What do you need the master's coat for? It won't even fit on your cursed shoulders." "I beg you not to be too clever," I said to my tutor. "Bring the coat here right now." "Lord God," my Savelich groaned, "the hareskin coat's nearly brand new, and it's for anybody but this beggarly drunkard." Nevertheless, the hareskin coat appeared. The mujik tried it on at once. Indeed, the coat, which I had already outgrown, was a bit tight on him. Nevertheless, he contrived to get into it, bursting at it at the seams. Savelich almost howled when he heard the threads rip. The vagabond was extremely pleased with my gift. He took me to the kibitka and said with a low bow, "Thank you, your honor. May the Lord reward you for your kindness. I'll never forget your good turn." He went his way, and I headed further on, paying no attention to Savelich's annoyance, and soon forgot about the previous day's blizzard, my guide, and my hareskin coat. But all that will be remembered later on, especially the hareskin coat.
It'll be a great surprise to find out who this guide was. Well, we'll end with some passages from the nonfiction Journey to Our's Room. In 1829, Pushkin was 30 years old. All his life he'd wanted to travel abroad, but the authorities never allowed him to leave Russia. And so in 1829, he got frustrated with sitting in St. Petersburg and decided to travel on his own and went to the Caucasus to join some of his friends who served in the Russian army there. Most of them, by the way, were Decembrists from this uprising, and they were the ones who weren't executed were punished by being sent to service in the Caucasus.
Demoted. They were demoted into ranks and had to
serve. They were his old friends, so he went to join them, though he was not in the army. Russia was then at war with Turkey. There were several Turkish wars. So Pushkin traveled through the Caucasus and Armenia and joined the army as a civilian and followed it to Ars Rum in Turkey, thereby violating the express orders of the Emperor Nicholas I. Pushkin was very elated about finally escaping the boundaries of Russia. Listen to how he writes about it. "My horse was ready. I set out with a guide. The morning was beautiful. The sun was shining. We rode across a wide meadow over thick green grass washed with dew and the drops of yesterday's rain. Before us sparkled a river which we would have to ford. Here is the Arpachai, the Cossack told me. Yarpachai, our border. I galloped to the river with an indescribable feeling I had never yet seen a foreign land. For me, there was something mysterious in a border, since childhood travel had been my favorite dream. Later, I led a nomadic life for a long time, but now in the south, both now in the south, now in the north, but I had never yet escaped the limits of boundless Russia. I joyfully rode into the cherished river, and my good horse carried me to the Turkish bank. But that bank had already been conquered. I was still in Russia. We will read from some of the travel notes, which he published actually 6 years after this journey. Here he is going out from Russia. The transition from Europe to Asia is felt more and more by the hour. Forests disappear, hills smooth out, grass becomes thicker and shows more vegetative force. Birds unknown in our forests appear. Eagles sit like sentinels on the mounds that mark the high road and gaze proudly at the travelers. Over the fertile pastures, and he quotes two lines of verse, indomitable mares proudly stray in herds. Kalmyks, a nomadic Mongolian people. Kalmyks settle around the station huts. Near their kibitkas graze their ugly, shaggy horses, known to you from the fine drawings of Orlovsky. The other day I visited a Kalmyk kibitka, crisscross wattle covered with a white felt. The whole family was preparing to have lunch. In the center, a cauldron was boiling and the smoke went out through an opening in the top of the kibitka. A young Kalmyk girl, not bad looking at all, was sewing and smoking a pipe. I sat down beside her. What's your name? Da da da. How old are you? 10 and 8. What are you sewing? Pant. For whom? Self. She handed me her pipe and started on lunch. In the cauldron, tea was boiling with mutton fat and salt. She offered me her dipper. I did not want to refuse and took a sip, trying to hold my breath. I do not think any other national cuisine could produce anything more vile. I asked for something to follow it up. They gave me a piece of dried mare's meat. I was glad enough of that. Kalmyk coquetry scared me. I hastily got out of the kibitka and rode away from this Circe of the steppe.
But he did write a very nice poem about this girl later. In Stavropol, I saw clouds on the edge of the sky that had struck my eyes exactly 9 years earlier. They were still the same, still in the same place. These were the snowy peaks of the Caucasian mountain range. From Georgievsk, I went to see hot springs. There I found great changes. In my time, the baths were in huts hastily slapped together. The springs, most of them in their primitive state, spurted, steamed, and poured down the mountain in all directions, leaving white or reddish traces behind them. We scooped up the seething water with a dipper made of bark or with the bottom of a broken bottle. Now magnificent baths and houses have been built. A boulevard lined with lindens follows around the slope of Mashuk. Everywhere there are clean paths, green benches, regular flower beds, bridges, pavilions. The sources have been fitted out and lined with stone. Police notices are tacked to the walls of the baths. Everywhere there is order, cleanliness, prettiness. I confess the Caucasian springs now offer more conveniences, but I regretted their former wild state. I regretted the steep stony paths, the bushes and the unfenced precipices over which I once clambered. With sadness, I left the springs and made my way back to Georgievsk. Night soon fell. The clear sky was strewn with millions of stars. I rode along the bank of the Patkumak. Alexander Raevsky used to sit there with me, listening to the melody of the waters. The outline of majestic Beshtu grew blacker and blacker in the distance, surrounded by its vassal mountains, and finally disappeared in the darkness.
The next morning we went on our way. Turkish prisoners were working on the road. They complained about the food they were given. They could never get used to Russian black bread. That reminded me of the words of my friend Sheremetev on his return from Paris. Life in Paris is bad, brother. Nothing to eat, no black bread for the asking. A Persian prince was expected. At some distance from Kazbek, several carriages came towards us and obstructed the narrow road. While the vehicles worked past each other, the convoy officer told us that he was accompanying a Persian court poet, and at my wish introduced me to Fazil Khan. With the help of an interpreter, I started on a grandiloquent oriental greeting. How ashamed I was when Fazil Khan responded to my inappropriate whimsicality with the simple, intelligent courtesy of a decent man. He hoped to see me in Petersburg. He was sorry that our acquaintance would be of short duration, and so on. Embarrassed, I was forced to abandon my pompously jocular tone and descend to ordinary European phrases. This is a lesson for our Russian love of mockery. In the future, I will not judge a man by his lambskin papacha and painted fingernails.
I stayed at an inn, and the next day headed for the famous Tiflis baths. Still famous. The city seemed populous to me. The Asiatic buildings and the market reminded me of Chisinau. Donkeys with panniers ran along the narrow and crooked streets. Carts harnessed to oxen blocked the way. Armenians, Georgians, Circassians, Persians thronged in the irregular square. Among them, young Russian officials rode on Karabakh stallions. At the entrance to the bath sat the owner, an old Persian. He opened the door for me. I entered the spacious room, and what did I see? More than 50 women, young and old, half-dressed and completely undressed, sat and stood undressing and dressing at benches placed along the walls. I stopped. Go on, the owner said to me. Today is Women's Day. Never mind, there's no harm. Of course there is no harm, I replied. On the contrary, the appearance of men did not make any impression. They went on laughing and talking among themselves. Not one of them hastened to cover herself with her chadra. Not one of them stopped undressing. It seemed I had entered invisibly. Many of them were indeed beautiful and justified the imagination of Thomas More, a lovely Georgian maid with all the bloom, the freshened glow of her own country maidens' looks when warm they rise from Tiflis brooks. This is from Lala Rukh by Thomas More. The Persian led me to the baths. The hot iron sulfur spring spilled into a deep basin carved in the rock. Never in my life have I met, either in Russia or in Turkey, with anything more luxurious than the Tiflis baths. He goes on to describe a massage. Very interesting.
I liked camp life very much. A cannon shot roused us at dawn. Sleeping in a tent was remarkably healthy. At dinner, we washed down Asiatic shashlik with English beer and champagne chilled in the snows of Taurida. Our company was diverse. In General Raevsky's tent, the beks of the Muslim regiments gathered. The conversation was conducted through an interpreter. In our army, there were both people of our Transcaucasian territories and inhabitants of recently conquered areas. Among them, I looked with curiosity at the Yazidis, reputed in the East to be devil worshippers. We've heard lately quite a bit about Yazidis. About 300 families live at the foot of Ararat. They have recognized the rule of the Russian sovereign. Their chief, a tall, ugly man in a red cape and a black hat, occasionally came with his respects to General Raevsky, commander of all the cavalry. I tried to find out from the Yazidi the truth about their beliefs. To my questions, he replied that the rumor that of the Yazidis supposedly worshiping Satan was an empty fable. That they believe in one God, that true, by their law, it was considered improper and ignoble to curse the devil, for he is now quite unhappy. But that in time he may be forgiven, for it is impossible to set limits to Allah's mercy. This explanation set me at ease. I was very glad for the Yazidis that they did not worship Satan, and their errors now seemed to me much more forgivable.
Pushkin is now on his way back to Russia. My crossing of the mountains was remarkable for me in that I was caught in a storm at night near Kobe. In the morning, going past Kazbek, I saw a marvelous sight. Ragged white clouds stretched across the peak of the mountain, and the solitary monastery, lit by the rays of the sun, seemed to be floating in the air, borne up by the clouds. The furious gully also showed itself to me in all its grandeur. The ravine filled with rainwater surpassed the raging Terek itself, roaring menacingly just beside it. The banks were torn to pieces, enormous rocks were dislodged and blocked the stream, a multitude of Ossetes were working on the road. I crossed over safely. Finally, I rode out of the narrow gorge into the expanse of the wide plains of Great Kabarda in Vladikavkaz, which is already Russia. I found Dorohov and Pushkin, his old friends from his lycée years. They were on their way to the waters to treat the wounds they had received in the present campaigns. On Pushkin's table, I found Russian magazines. The first article I happened upon was a review of one of my works. In it, I and my verses were denounced in all possible ways. I started reading it aloud. Pushkin interrupted me, demanding that I read with greater mimetic art. It should be noted that the review was decked out with the usual whimsies of our critics. It was a conversation between a sexton, a bread baker woman, and a proofreader, the Mr. Common Sense of this little comedy. I found Pushkin's request so amusing that the vexations produced in me by the reading of the article vanished completely, and we burst into wholehearted laughter. Such was my first greeting in my dear fatherland. And we are now back in New York.
And thank you for listening patiently. I believe something is going to follow up.
Yes.
Here she comes.
Elif comes.
Yeah, we're all going to sit. And
they told me to sit there.
Oh,
I don't know
there?
Why.
OK. That's right. They did tell me to sit here. And now I remembered it, and I'm going to do it. OK. So we're going to have a short conversation, and then we're going to open this up to a few audience questions. And that's going to be our life now. OK. I thought maybe to start with, people who don't know must be super curious about your method of collaboration, how you work together. So if you could describe that a little bit and whether it was different at all for the Pushkin book.
Well, we sit down and just work together.
So I think you do your part first.
Yeah, I do the first draft, trying to be close to the original whenever it is possible.
Trying to write very badly.
Yes, well, people say literal translation. I always maintain that literal translations don't exist. It's never literal, but I try to convey what goes on there, and then Richard reads it.
Yeah. No, I read it. I have the Russian original. If there are other translations, I also look at them, usually after I've done my part. But then I take that and try to make it live in English while still catching as close as possible, keeping as close as possible to the original. I think that one of the best things about translation is the way it nourishes the language that you're translating into, that it opens possibilities that you might not think of, or that your submission to the conventions of your own language don't suggest to you, but suddenly something new appears, and you can try that in English.
It's not anything new. I mean, it has been happening in history. You know, there's always languages enriched each other through translation a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was reading your Paris Review interview where you were talking about a particular phrase from, I think, one of the Belkin tales, The Blizzard, mortally in love, that you were translating the phrase mortally in love, and that, so it really made me think about translation in different ways, so that when you're doing your part, it seems like you're going through looking for what's a cliche so you know what to translate literally word for word versus what to give sort of a figurative equivalent to, and that seems like it would be cut and dry to use a cliche. That makes sense, right? So like if you were translating that, you wouldn't use the word cut and dry. but for something like mortally in love, I think you said that you asked people, do you use that phrase? And they said, well, yeah, we use it because of Pushkin. And then I thought it must be...
in Russian.
But Pushkin was actually the first, second. Krylov used it in the 18th century once. And then Pushkin used it. And after that, it became a Russian cliche. But what do we do?
Yes, I was wondering how do you handle that with...
Well, how does it strike you as mortally in love? Is it...
Sounds good.
So I would because imagine it makes one pause a little bit.
It does. It doesn't sound completely...
On the other hand, what could you do? What is the cliché?
I don't know. Someone wrote to us and suggested that we missed the right cliché.
But the right... terrible, awful in love, or madly in love, head over heels in love. They just don't work.
Dying of love, yeah. Hopeless. That's a
good
hopelessly in love. Doesn't work. For me, it didn't work. Hopelessly in love. She is sick. She's actually dying. She's dying of love, and she's mortally in love.
Fair. I think that's fair.
Besides, I think when you read the text, it's one thing to discuss it like that, to look at it closely under the microscope. Mm-hmm. But if you read the text, it just goes over, I'm sure.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I was wondering if there were a lot of challenges like that translating Pushkin, because he did so much to shape Russian literary language. Was it, and how did you handle those decisions when they came up? Did you go more on the side of literality or more on the side of trying to make it read, or is that not an actual thought process that makes sense when you're translating?
Yes.
Okay. that's just as I thought.
No, the...
Actually, there weren't so many problems. The most difficult thing translating Pushkin was that, I don't know how to say it, he's never banal. Mm-hmm. His language is never odd. Mm-hmm. It's always a normal Russian language.
Mm-hmm. And it's quite simple, as you heard.
And yes, and but it's never banal. So the difficulty is not to fall into complete cliches, not to make it flat.
Right. Yeah.
It has to remain very fresh, but still very normal.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's really interesting.
Yeah, the trouble with Pushkin, as opposed to all the other Russian writers, is that he's perfect. and it's very simple. It's simply perfect. Mm-hmm. And to be confronted with that is quite terrifying. Mm-hmm. Because you can substitute rhetoric for rhetoric. Tolstoy is filled with multiple suspended sentences, and you can do that in English, but Pushkin is simply, it's very simple but exactly alive, and the key to that is hard to find. Mm-hmm. But that's how I would try to do it.
Did you translate the verse in Egyptian Nights yourself? I actually wanted to ask about
that. Yes.
How was that different? Have you translated verse before?
Yeah, I've translated quite a lot of verse.
Done a lot.
Yeah.
How, you know what? I can't even ask what I want to ask. What, okay.
don't.
One of my favorite Russian essays is My Pushkin by the poet Marina Tsvetaeva. Mm-hmm. And when you read that, you realize, I read it in college when I was just getting interested in Russian, and that's something that you then learn, is that every Russianist has their Pushkin, and that it's a very personal thing, mm-hmm. especially for people who grew up there, because then it's something that happened in childhood, but really for everyone, no matter when you come to it. And I was wondering if both of you could tell us a little your Pushkin, when you encountered it, how, what role he's played for you.
Well, I don't know. We began reading Pushkin when we were very young, because he wrote fairy tales in verse, and every Russian child knows them by heart from age, I don't know, five, mm-hmm. really. You live with Pushkin. Pushkin enters your life.
How do you feel about it? Do you love it? Or is there resentment towards it?
Never, no. It's pure love.
And you're memorizing from an early age.
You just memorize it by repetition.
Yeah.
There's such beautiful verses that they just stay with you forever.
And how did you come, how and when did you come to Pushkin?
I had read quite a few things translated, like Mandelstam's writings about Pushkin, and Akhmatova's writings about Pushkin, and Tsvetaeva's writings about Pushkin, and Sinyavsky. And I had read what was available. I read all the prose in two different editions. And the poetry's trickier, translating it into English. Not that people are put off by that, because I think we've recently had three more complete translations of Yevgeny Onegin, which is considered his greatest work, all in rhyming English verse. Mm. So, and there's, of course, Nabokov's deliberately awful translation. Which he said, I revise it and made it worse. But it's a very, very interesting book. I am too.
Yeah.
I mean, too. I think it's.
And his commentary
is a good way of
doing it. His commentary is amazing.
It's a good way of doing it, because at least he says what Pushkin says. Mm-hmm. Because once you start rhyming, poetry goes. I mean.
The poetry is. But it's not his poetry.
It ceases to be Pushkin's poetry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have to chase things just for the rhymes.
We did
translate one of his comic children's poems.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, the tale of the preacher and his man Bumpkin.
Okay, that's great. I actually have a translation. I was reading up on Pushkin, knowing I was going to come and talk to you, and I read an anecdote that after he wrote Boris Godunov, he wrote a letter to Vyazemsky where he said what is translated in Wikipedia and has its own Wikipedia page as he writes to Vyazemsky, oh, I finished Boris Godunov and I said to myself, oh, you Pushkin, oh, you son of a bitch. And this Aida Pushkin. And someone commented, I put that immediately on Twitter, and a Russian speaker immediately commented that Aida does not, it's not OU. I was wondering how,
Aida
it seems
means
like it's not, right? It's
oh, oh, what a, pu- what yeah. a Pushkin.
What a Pushkin. What a son of a bitch.
Okay, I think that Wikipedia was pretty close. Thank you. So I guess the first of your translations that I read and that really made my head explode was Brothers Karamazov, and I had, you know, because I'd been reading about Bakhtin's and dialogism, and with a lot of the translations you don't get the dialogism, you don't get all of the registers, and that was what I understood that first from your translation, and then I was able to go back and see it in the Dostoevsky. It's such a difficult thing. And so I guess this is sort of a belated thank you for that. But you've translated the most of your translations, the largest number are Dostoevsky, right? Was that the first that you did? So how is it, this is a collaboration that kind of started with Dostoevsky, how has it changed as you go through different writers? It must be so, was there like a practice that started with Or was it a plan to do Dostoevsky and then you thought, oh, this worked really well, let's expand it out, and then...
It wasn't really a plan at all. We were... We never even thought about publishing it. I wanted to try to do it because we were talking about it, and I was reading a translation in English. Larissa started reading the original just out of curiosity, and then she would say, how did they translate that? And she would look and say, ah, I see they didn't translate that. And she said it so many times that I began to think, could it be translated? Is it necessary?
They just left it out? There were things that they just left out.
Yeah, or didn't notice.
They sort of flattened it. Dostoevsky would say that someone just filched her inheritance. And the Constance Garnett, who's very good translator, but she would say stole or pocketed. Mm-hmm. But Dostoevsky would use really a strong, not vulgarism, but a slangy word. Mm-hmm. And it was so very often.
Mm-hmm. But I began thinking about, especially with Dostoevsky, and this is dialogism or whatever that's now called, that I began to notice that there is no authoritative voice in his writing. And this is a fascinating thing because he undermines the narrator himself, which should make us all very uneasy, you know. Wait, if he's wrong, then who's right? You know? And the whole story becomes suspended this way because there is no final voice. Tolstoy, you know, will tell you exactly what you should think. And he says, this is me, Tolstoy, and I tell you, this is, and this happened like this, and they're all wrong, but this is what it was like. But the complexity of and it's an inner quality of Dostoevsky, that, because it leads to inner movement. I think it's the most central thing in Dostoevsky's work, is always the possibility of rising. Even, you know, Dmitri Karamazov, who can hardly even express himself, but he, you see this happening in him, you know, his soul is rising through the torments. There's three chapters called with that title.
And there is also often.
And it's done stylistically by the lack of authority, which Dostoevsky grants. There is no judgment within the novel. The judgment is elsewhere.
Yeah. Yeah, there was a sentence that you quoted in that interview, that it's because it can't be resolved, I've resolved to leave it irresolvable or something like that. But constant undermining of it.
There's also very often one hero is described through the eyes of another hero, which makes them both alive, very alive. They become three-dimensional, you know, that it's like Miusov is described through the eyes of Mitya when they come to the monastery. There is a wonderful place where he described this liberal-minded European man. Stalichny, zagranichny, you know. Then the
that's what I mean by style. You know,
I still remember
this little jingling rhyme of these words.
Metropolitan, cosmopolitan, we translated it. We just were very lucky there. I looked at another translation, and there was a man who lived in capitals and abroad, you know. It's not exactly the same. Like,
You get the same information, but not the voice. So that's what really struck
me. And
there's
a lot of things like that in Dostoevsky.
I guess maybe we should open this up to.
Should we turn on the
lights? Oh yeah, so we could see people.
Yeah, we don't see anything.
See?
Oh, there you all are.
There they all are.
Hey. Okay, so maybe let's take some audience questions. Yes.
Just wondering if you could recite some Pushkin from your childhood that you remember, some of the verse.
Can you recite some verse?
Oh, so the question is if you could recite some Pushkin for us from memory.
Yes.
From childhood.
Yeah, I could. Of course I could.
I'm sure you could, but would you mind?
Yes.
Or anything that comes to
Князю синє море ходить, синє море глаз не сводит. Глядь поверх текучих вод, лебедь белая плывет. Здравствуй, князь ты мой прекрасный, что ж ты тих, как день ненастный? Опечалился чему, говорит она ему. Князь Гвидон ей отвечает. Грусть, тоска меня съедает, одолела молодца. Видеть я б хотела отца. Ну и так далее.
Айда Пушкин.
Айда сукин син. Thank you. Any other questions, requests? Yes.
Can you give perhaps another example or a theme which demonstrates how Pushkin has influenced either Tolstoy or Dostoevsky in their writings?
So another example of how Tolstoy or Dostoevsky. Gogol, you
Gogol,
know?
Yes, Gogol's yes. The actual Pushkin gave.
They were friends.
Gogol, the topic for dead souls, that was Pushkin, and for Revizor too. In fact, that happened to Pushkin
Revizor
himself.
The inspector.
Inspector general, yes. In fact, that happened to Pushkin himself. He arrived somewhere and was taken for some important government official, which he was not at all.
And treated very nicely.
Yes. These are most famous examples with Gogol.
Yeah, that's amazing.
But what about Dostoevsky?
You know, it's not. It's
Dostoevsky's last were his lecture on Pushkin in 1880 on the anniversary of Pushkin's death. His very famous Pushkin speech, which just awakened the whole audience to his cause. But in his writing, well,
It's very hard to pinpoint. You know, it's simply he's ever present in Russian literature. But I guess it's for linguists and philologists to say it. I couldn't find an
example.
Well,
I mean, there are these subjects like this example you gave about Tolstoy, reading this little fragment. The guests were arriving at the dacha because there's a woman in that story who was the first sort of sketch in his mind for Anna Karenina. Mm-hmm. His first version of Anna Karenina, she was a rotten bitch, you know, but the more he worked on it, the better she became, and the worse everyone else became. So
the more he liked her, you know, because
Tolstoy actually began to fall in love with Anna herself, even though she was a sinner.
Pushkin is very much present in Russian poetry. Akhmatova, Tsvetaeva, but the whole 19th century, that he's there. They all read him. They all read him and sort of either...
Yeah, what is it?
Were directly influenced or just worked against his influence. But he's ever present. What is it, your...
Well, the great Russian symbolist poet Alexander Blok, during the 1920s, the revolution, post-revolution. I don't know if, yes. Yeah, he says, Bloch wrote this in 1921 in revolutionary Petrograd. From early childhood, our memory keeps the cheerful name Pushkin. This name, this sound, fills many days of our life. The grim names of emperors, generals, inventors of the tools of murder, the tormented and the tormentors of life, and beside them, Pushkin.
Yes.
This is very beautifully put.
That is very beautifully put.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would run into enormous problems. Because I never studied Russian. I've learned by being married to it. I've learned a great deal of Russian. In order to defend myself against my children, I had to learn Russian. I have learned a great deal of Russian by our work, but if I were to set out on my own, I would be unable to do it. So it's always for us is a matter of real exchange.
Maybe two more questions. Yes, you with the yes.
How often do you disagree on a translation and who usually
wins? So how often do you disagree on a translation and who usually
wins?
We
never disagree.
What is it? Actually, it's true.
I think she always wins. That's no.
We call it discussion.
No, it's true. We never disagree. We each have our own authority. I mean, I'm the final judge of the English that we produce. But I have to listen.
I never challenge that.
But I have to listen to when Larissa says, yes, that's good English, but that's not what Tolstoy wrote. It's not quite what he said. And this is what's really enriching in our work together, because that draws me back to the original, and I have to face the living quality of the original when Larissa presents me with it, confronts me with it. But it's never a disagreement. It's always this mutual kind of work.
That sounds like such an enviable collaborative situation. Okay, one more question. Oh, the one I saw was that one.
Is there, of your translation projects, is there one that you hold most dear to you? And on the other hand, is there a translation project that you got involved in and had to push through even though you really wanted to give up at some point?
So the question is there a favorite translation and is there one that you committed to and then were less than thrilled about later?
That's very hard. I always thought that I was a Dostoevskian, and then we started translating Tolstoy, and I thought, well, I'm really not a Tolstoyan, you know. And then I thought, well, but after all, Tolstoy is easy compared to Dostoevsky, and then I discovered that that was quite wrong. And I also discovered that I actually, in some way, was a Tolstoyan. And I got converted into Tolstoy. But then I got converted to Chekhov and thought, who cares about all this Tolstoy and Dostoevsky? Chekhov is so perfect. But then we finally wound up, luckily we ended, more or less, with Pushkin. Because I don't know, if we began with him, I probably wouldn't be able to do anything else.
Okay, on that
note, that was not really
perfection.
An answer.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming.
Yeah, thank you for coming. Have a good night.